So the project I have shared with you, that was the salient features of the NEP. You have to write a report on it. First of all, you will just find out. I want you to take out a few days, right, in which you will collect the material. Just read about it. Gather information, right? So I have announced the topic. I'm giving you time to collect information, find out about it, and then I'll come to the next part. That is how you're going to write your report, okay? Right, as I said, I'll discuss all that in the class regarding a presentation, regarding the acknowledgement, regarding the bibliography, right? So you'll be giving, when your acknowledgement, you'll be giving that certificate of completion that I've completed my work and it has been submitted to my teacher, right? So that comes in the end. First of all, I want you to find out. And as a student, what do you think about it? Right, so you'll be writing that report in your point of view, how it is going to be beneficial. Naturally, it is there because everything is kind of revamped and restructured. So many changes are made there, right? So we have competency-based learning, you have experiential learning, right? You have project-based learning, we have skills, so many things which have been introduced. So how is it going to be beneficial? So just take out 1 week. I'm giving you till next Friday. Read about it, okay? Then we will start with the drafting part, okay? And yes, here, so we have to do it very nicely, very properly, because at the end of the day, when you submit me your file, when I assess you for your exams, I'll be asking you questions also, Viva, from this, from the report that you have written, okay? Right? So first of all, what are you going to find out? You're going to read about this national education policy. Right? There's enough information on the internet. You can find out and right, you can maybe even go to the CBSE site and you can find out information about it. So 1 week is enough for you all to read about it? Yes? Is it okay? Enough, I think so, in which you can just at least get an idea about it, right? Then we move on to the next part. So we, of course, we also move on to the next part. That is, we continue with the reading of the chapter Landscape of the Soul. Landscape of the soul. So we have the landscape which is on the canvas, right? You have the paintings on the canvas. Now we're also going to read about that, how this landscape, that how does it reflect our soul? How does it reflect our thoughts, our ideas, right? And art as it is an expression of so many things, right? What are the various art forms? Can you tell me about art forms here? Yes. So even like your theater, you have your dance, all these are art forms, your sculpture, everything is there in which you are able to express your feelings, your emotions. Now, when it comes to dance and drama and music, you know, we're able to understand, right? But when it comes to paintings, it's quite difficult because here it is our perspective. It is the way we look at that. And how are we going to understand it, right? So this is what we had started with the reading, and we had read about the Chinese art form and the European art form. So what is their very particular or the very important characteristic of the European art form? What was it? European art form is likeness, right? So realism. So likeness, that is reflected in the art forms over there. So we had an example of the Chinese art form, yes? Or rather, we read an incident also. Now the emperor and the painter Wu Daozi, and how he, you know, like disappeared along with his painting because he wanted to show that path to the emperor, but he was unable to understand. And so he disappeared along with his painting. We have another example where the painter was afraid to complete the painting of a dragon. That if he painted the eye of the dragon, what might happen? Might come alive and it might fly away. And, you know, it, as I said, our culture is reflected in our art form. So we have a lot of influence, you know, like mythological influence and like the spiritual influence. And that is, they're reflected in our art form also. So when you look at the rock sculptures also, when you look at the dance forms also, right? So they are all there, you know, showing that thought, showing, the dedication, devotion, right? So when you listen to the, you know, music also, like you listen to Kathak music, or yes, you have your like Odissi and your Bharatnatyam and all, right? So Kathakali and everything there. So, and when you look at the Kathakali dance, you know, what is there? That eyes expression, you have, do you know what it is? Right, so now that dress is there and mask worn on the face and how the eye movements and everything. It is as if everything is there right before you're able to understand what the dancer is trying to portray, right? So what we cannot understand, it's not paintings. And why here? Because each one of us likes to interpret it in our own way. So the, yes, the painter is very clear. This is what I want you to see. But here he is also giving you that liberty to understand it in your own way. And this is when you talk about the Chinese art form. And when you read about the Chinese culture, you will find about, so whether it is about the, you know, like the food habits, it's about the festivals they celebrate. So there are all these, naturally there is a tradition behind everything. If you remember in your class 10th, when you did Glimpses of India, when you read tea, right? And you had the legends which were there associated with the tea, right? So we had that how the Chinese emperor that by mistake only, so that you can say that tea, you know, like that branch or the few leaves of it fell, and when it got boiled, he liked the taste. Yeah, so that too was there, you know. Yeah, but of course, you have a valid reason. We did not give the exam, so we don't remember what was done, isn't it? Yeah, you give the exams only then that retaining power is there. Okay, let's continue here. So we have another example from the Chinese landscape, from the Chinese paintings. What is very, very clear? The painter has a very important position, right? And he wants the viewer also to understand his viewpoint, and he wants him to appreciate that what is it that I'm trying to show. So whether it was about the emperor or it was about the painter making the dragon or not completing the dragon. Second example, we had of European painting, and it was even a blacksmith becoming a good painter. Why? Because he could create a likeness. He made a fly on the panel. Yes, and that fly was so same and so alive, you can say, that yes, the painter came and tried to, you can say, what hit the fly. But then he realized, and there, what do people look for? Perfection, likeness, realism. Okay, this is one of the biggest difference. When we talk about Chinese art, they want to focus on the essence of life. They want to teach you lessons of life by looking at these paintings. So we'll carry on with this now. This paragraph we had read. So in the Chinese story, this is where we have to start from. Yes, okay. Now in the Chinese story, the emperor commissions a painting and appreciates its outer appearance. So the emperor, he just looked at the painting every day. He did not even notice that there is a cave over there. He did not try to, you know, like appreciate the little things that were there. Okay. But the artist reveals to him the true meaning of his work. The emperor was unable to understand. And the artist came, he showed him the cave, and then he disappeared along with his painting. The emperor may rule over the territory he has conquered, but only the artist knows the way within. Artists talk about the reality of society, don't they? So when you look at pictures, you know, right? Yes, so simple scenes that would have been everyday life. We are able to get an idea what life would have been like. So artists, yes, so they're reflecting upon that. The emperor, yeah, he is there looking over his kingdom, but he is not able to appreciate what is happening inside. Who shows that? The artist shows that, right? Let me show the way. The Tao, a word that means both the path or the method and the mysterious works of the universe. The painting is gone, but the artist has reached his goal beyond any material appearance. The painting disappeared, but the artist has left behind a very important message that I wanted to show you the way to understand. You would have entered that cave, you would have realized and seen the beauty of your kingdom. But the emperor was just focusing on the outer appearances. So he lost the true meaning or the true beauty of that poet. So Tao is that way, okay? Now, a classical Chinese landscape is not meant to reproduce an actual view, as would a Western figurative painting. Please note this down. This is very, very important here. So what about Chinese landscape? It is not necessarily an actual view. Whereas when you talk about European painting, it is a replica, right? Whereas a European painter wants you to borrow his eyes and look at a particular landscape exactly as he saw it from a specific angle, the Chinese painter does not choose a single viewpoint. So when you look around here, when you read about, the important paintings here, whether it's Michelangelo or Rembrandt or Leonardo da Vinci. So it is there. Yes, what is there is there. There is no hidden meaning. There is nothing that you have to really go deep into. Later on, as the forms of painting change, you know, when we read about abstract art, so many forms together. So you had to really understand what is it that the painter is trying to say. Now, this is in the Chinese painting. He just wants you to enter it from any angle and try to understand it. European painter, this is what I've made. And I want to you to appreciate what I have created. Is this clear? His landscape is not a real one. And you can enter it from any point, then travel in it. But do we actually do that? Do we take our time to appreciate art? We look at the color. We look at light. Does it look nice? Right? So we really don't take our time to appreciate the essence of that painting. And what is it the painter wants us to do? Understand what he's trying to say, what he's trying to convey. And which painter in particular? Chinese painter. He wants us to understand that, yes, it is the essence of life he's showing you. I've shown you a landscape. You can look at it from any angle and try to understand it. European, see here, it might be a replica or a portrait of a beautiful landscape or a beautiful woman, right? Or a countryside scene here. Wants you to appreciate the beauty. That see how the colors are perfect, how the form, everything, whatever is there that you have to understand about art. His landscape is not a real one and you can enter it from any point and travel in it. The artist creates a path for your eyes to travel up and down, then back again in a leisurely movement. This is even more true in the case of the horizontal scroll, in which the action of slowly opening one section of the painting, then rolling it up to move on the other, adds a dimension of time which is unknown in any other form of painting. Have you heard of the scroll? We do, ma'am. We scroll a lot. The whole day we do that. But that scrolling is different from the Chinese painting, right? So what is that scroll? We have invitations also like that. So they roll like that and you open it and then you open it and then you keep on reading the content. That scroll, yes. Now Chinese paintings are also like that. So here it is like you can say that kind of a horizontal scroll you have in parts. You open one part, then the next. So it keeps on adding. And you keep on having that element of, you can say that surprise is there. What is going to be there? What is the complete picture like? What is it that the artist is trying to convey, right? So as if you're traveling through time, another dimension has been added to it. Then yes, it also requires the active participation of the viewer who decides at what pace he will travel through the painting. Will he open it at one go? Or will he take time, right? One step at a time, appreciating each part of the painting. A participation which is physical as well as mental. How physical? Opening, scrolling. Mental, thinking, understanding what is there in the painting. The Chinese painter does not want you to borrow his eyes. He wants you to enter his mind. The landscape is an inner one, a spiritual and conceptual space. How is it different now? What is so special about the Chinese art form? What is special about the Chinese art form? Yes, what does the painter want you to see? Yeah? No idea? Yes, the hidden details. What is he trying to show you? The message that he's trying to convey you, right? And here, the landscape, it is not only of the from the eyes he wants you to visualize. He wants to use your mind as well. Try to understand what is he trying to convey. Is there a message? Is he trying to teach an important lesson of life? Is he giving, you know, like, is there some kind of a spirituality there? This is one big difference between European painting and thank God you know this much. Okay? Yes, all my sleeping. What? So are we awake? Are we listening? Really? Okay. Can I just tell you who is sleeping right now? Now, this concept is expressed as Shan Shui. What is this concept? This concept that, yes, you the mind here, there is that inner space that you have to use and understand. One thing else here, this concept is expressed as Shan Shui, literally mountain water, Shan Shui, which used together represent the word landscape, mountain water. Let's go back to the times when we made a landscape and the landscape had mountains and the landscape had the river flowing. So that mountain water. Now, when you talk about Chinese culture, you know, like one very important aspect of their culture is maintaining that balance. Oh, ma'am, don't talk about Chinese culture nowadays. We are not happy with the COVID thing and everything, right? Please, we're not discussing them. But the things are there. It has really taken over the world and it has given many things here. What about wind chimes and all? Do you like to put those wind chimes in your homes? Why? Why? The sound. So when the wind blows, you have that sound. And why? You know, like, of course, basic concept is the energy. Now, when we talk about it, we have in our own culture, we have Vastu Shastra. Yes. What is the basic concept of that? Energy. Yes. We need that positivity, right? So the way you arrange your things and, of course, which direction the sunlight comes, where fire should be there, where water has to be there. So it is there to create that balance and to create a positive energy. So when we talk about here, similarly in Chinese, we have feng shui, right? So shan shui is something else. We have feng shui there, right? What is that? That is also maintaining a balance. And when we think about Chinese things here, you know, like, okay, right, they wonder where the teacher has disappeared. Here I am. And so we have, you know, like the food also. When you look at the Chinese food, there's that element of sweetness and sourness, right? So to maintain that balance. So basic idea, one very important thought is to maintain a balance, right? Yes or no? So what is Shan Shui? Shan Shui is like mountain water. This is what basically it means. Shan Shui means is concept. Using your mind to understand the paintings, the art form. More than two elements of an image, these represent two complementary poles. reflecting the Taoist view of the universe. So Taoist, right? Wu Daozi, showing us the way of life. What was his way? Mountain is yang, reaching vertically towards heaven, stable, warm, and dry in the sun. While the water is yin, horizontal, resting on the earth, fluid, moist, cool. So we have those two elements there, maintaining that balance. So the mountain and the water, right? And in other words here, yin and yang. Have you heard of that? Yes, where have you heard of that? So you have, you know, like, of course, you have your keychains also. We have our wind chimes also. So there's that symbol, isn't it? So yeah. So you have that symbol, that yin and yang. So that means what is it that you've been looking at all these years and you're not able to understand? Yin and yang, the masculine element and the feminine element. And we need both of them to maintain a balance in life. Yes or no? So if one is more and the other is less, what will happen? An imbalance. That is why when you talk about here, the Chinese culture, it is there, you know, like maintaining that harmony. So whether it is shan shui or whether it is yin and yang, okay, right? So if you've seen that, you've seen those charms also, those bracelets also you have, so with the yin and yang, okay. The interaction of yin, the receptive feminine aspect of universal energy, and its counterpart yang, active and masculine, is of course a fundamental notion of Taoism. So we have in our Hindu mythology also, where has this concept of feminism and masculinity been balanced? Think over it and let me know. What is it called? Where it has been? So if you are aware of it, you let me know. Tell me tomorrow. Right? So where in our culture, where in the Hindu culture has this balance been there? We have this image where masculinity and femininity has been balanced. It's a portrayal. Right? Think over it and let me know tomorrow. So yes, so what is yin? What is yin? Yin is the feminine aspect. What is yang? Yang is the masculine aspect. And both of them, they create a balance. Okay? Right? So both elements have to be present. What is often overlooked is an essential third element. The middle void where their interaction takes place. This can be compared with the yogic practice of pranayama. Breathe in, retain, breathe out. The suspension of the breath is the void where meditation occurs. Have you tried breathing exercises? Yes? So it's not as simple as it seems. It's not just breathing out and breathing in. So there's a moment where you have to hold your breath, right? And then release. Yeah. So this is what he's saying, like where that moment where you hold your breath, this is middle void. Now we're going to discuss these terms here. And I'll be discussing them again with you all, where the interaction takes place, where the interaction of the yin and the yang, right? The suspension of breath is the void where meditation occurs. The middle void is essential. Nothing can happen without it. So middle void, emptiness. So when you look at Chinese paintings, are they crowded with too much of information, as you might say? No, there's emptiness. Why is that emptiness? So you can understand it. So you can take your angle, you can take your view about it. You can make your own opinion, okay? So the middle void is essential. Nothing can happen without it. Hence the importance of the white, unpainted space in Chinese landscape. When you start making a painting, oh my God, I bought so many colors and I have this canvas. Why should I leave this space? It will seem incomplete. This is what we see, no? If a painting is there and some blank space is there, we think, yo, it's still incomplete. Is something left to be done? But in Chinese paintings, that blank is there. That emptiness is there. Why? So the viewer can understand it from his or her viewpoint. Clear? Okay, I'm putting an end here, and we'll